This is the OTB Television Network, a service of Capital District Off-Track Betting.
Welcome to the Handicappers Report on this Thursday morning. Seth Merrow and Anthony Morimino, and weather outside. A little bit frightful. This morning it's okay. It's supposed to turn around tonight into tomorrow, but we're focusing on Tampa and Gulfstream, so they're racing this afternoon.
Wednesday.
Sunny and warm.
Wednesday is good. Maybe they heard the little question I asked Seth before we came on the air. Andy Beyer has written a follow-up column to the story he had that basically started something that we've talked about a lot, the two of us, whether it's the Japan Racing Association, the Hong Kong Racing Association. I'm going back, 10 years ago, Seth, when I used to do the Sunday morning Handicappers Report by myself, when we'd watch the Japan Cup, and every single horse would be timed intervals to the hundredths of a second, no margin of anything, and we haven't gotten to there. I know we have discussed how great their website have been, you know, to dial it up and to learn. And, you know, as a guy who follows Gulfstream Park in Tampa and does on my Excel spreadsheet, and keep the run-up and the temporary rails information in a separate column for the temporary rail for the turf racing, it's now gotten preposterous. And one of the things...
Yeah, when you put that in, little did you know that 250 did not mean 250.
No, in case you missed it, he followed up because I think he followed up because I think he was surprised at how much traction it got. But, and I would be like Andy Beyer surprised too, because I've been screaming about it for 20 years. I'm like, why can't we start exactly at the six? You know, I don't care that they go 25.24 if they start from a standing start, etc. I think he was surprised at how much traction the story got, and then this situation at Gulfstream Park. And I have said, Jeff Carl likes to tease me on Friday and Saturdays when the races come up at 7.5 furlongs. He'll always say Anthony Morimino's favorite distances, and one of my cries has been not only here but at Fairgrounds. I'm like, can we get an exact distance here? You people have played fast and loose with timing mechanisms for 100 years. Now distance. And the one thing I say, I never studied surveying, whatever it's called. But the one thing I think that they use, Seth, is they try and find a permanent marker or something. And you have to have something. Well, at the 7.5 furlong races, and you really only have to look at a couple. Andy mentions one on March 5th. But it's... one of them, the one that he's referring to, they're back so far, which has now been listed at 375 feet. They're at the lake. And the other times, they're in front of the lake, so that's your point of reference. They don't move the light pole that's in the middle of the lake, not in the lake, but the middle of the side of the lake, etc. And I like what the gentleman said at Equibase. We never, apparently their software maxes out at 250. So he said, and I think rightfully so, we never imagined it would be more than 80 yards beyond the real distance. And if you notice in the charts, the one that Andy Beyer listed was revised. Now it says at the bottom of the chart, because it apparently talked about the software, where the run-up is on Equibase, apparently they can't change that, which, by the way, I'm suspicious of. This industry, and now it says 375. There's other races that say 315. And the point that really gets into, that's 100 yards. That's a 16th of a mile. Then he goes on and on and on. And it's been...
And he talked about a specific race. This was the follow-up article that came out yesterday, at which the original chart had the run-up listed as 250. Beyer subsequently finds out that they can only go up to 250. Right. It was actually 375, which is essentially, you're talking a 16th of a mile. So that 7.5 furlong race now becomes a mile race. And I said on Racing Across America yesterday, that was personal to me. Because the specific race he talked about where the Pletcher horse was stepping up in distance and took the lead late in the race only to get passed by a horse coming back that had a little more stamina. Well, that horse was the one horse that I lost in the Rainbow Six that day. So for me, that was personal. And that 7.5, as Byer said, at 7.5, this horse has a good potential to win. At a mile, it's a little bit different. And there's no way that for the betting public to be aware of that situation, even after the race, up until Byer kind of sussed this out a little bit. And so it is certainly a conversation worth having within the industry. And
yeah, a short one, by the way.
Well, and yeah, these days it seems logical. And I get the point
How
where
about
they don't want to
line.
Put ruts in the track, but I think they could move back and forth a minimal distance that would still keep it within the frame of reference, but you could time out of the gate.
It's so wrong. I mean, this situation that Seth's referring to me is borderline malfeasance to the betting public. I mean, that's something different. But I also want to say something else on what I like to say about watching the races, collecting your own information. Don't even listen to me. You know, get your own information. I was talking to Randy Moss last year before he came on your show last summer at Racing Across America at Saratoga, because we were talking about the sprint racing at Saratoga, and I said to him, I don't always believe the run-up in the Equibase charge. Matter of fact, Equibase does, to me, now I'm anal retentive and I have no problem chasing down information, I have no problem with opinion. They do not set a high enough standard to be the official. Elias Sports Bureau for sports does a better job than Equibase does. I've tried to send them corrected information. I don't even get a response, so I don't use them. To me, they're the borderline Wikipedia. They're a good starting place. This was what I said to Randy, and I think I'm going to see him again, see if he ever looked it up. They were using different run-ups for the 5.5 furlong sprint distances at Saratoga. Now, if you've ever been on the backside, you know there's not much room there. And then talking about a point of reference, there's a gap in the hedge that is almost always two strides out of the gate when they go 5.5 furlongs. So I saw the different run-ups, and I'm like, there's no different run-ups. They're coming from marginally within 3 feet of each other out of the starting gate at 5.5. And Randy looked at me and said, really? I said, watch. And I gave him two specific races where they gave different run-ups. And I said, you'll see there's a gap in the hedge, the inside hedge, and you'll see the 6-furlong pole for the dirt track, which is pretty noticeable, red and white stripe. I said, and your eye will tell you that it's about two strides to the gap in the hedge, and about, I forget, I want to say 5 to when they pass the 6-furlong pole for the dirt course, always. And so to me, that tells me the run-up is essentially the same within 1 foot, 2 foot, 3 foot. But I was glad I got traction. Seth and I have talked about it for a long time. For a guy who used to run track and field, I said it many times, I don't understand how I can't get the individual exact timing of these horses and the exact distance that they run. I also want to say,
you're saying you don't believe Equibase. So at that point, you're stuck with your eyeball. There's not another source. That's the source.
Yeah, my
eyeball. So everybody's stuck with that.
I've said this before. The toughest one is Tampa Bay on their turf course, which is beautiful. The temporary rails. You know why? You ever notice this about Tampa Bay? They are like Arlington and Gulfstream Park in that they move the rails. It's very difficult, Tampa Bay. Tampa Bay does not have on their turf course permanent rails set close to the pole markers, and then they bring out a second set that's temporary. They actually move it. I have to watch how far away the quarter pole and the fence is. It makes it very, very difficult. They have one set of railing. So when the temporary rails are up, you don't have that what we're used to in New York, which is, well, there's clearly the temporary rails because over there are the permanent rails. So I don't trust them. I was teasing Jeff, and this is a little one. The other day they ran the Swale Stakes, and the Daily Racing Form was reporting it in their charts and in the past performance, like the 34th running. I said, Jeff, do you believe him? He goes, I probably believe you. I go, good thinking. It's not that they.
I'm wondering how they, a place like Tampa then, does the moving out of the rail. What do they measure from as they're going around the course?
I don't trust it. I just move on. I do not. I've said, we go back. You look
But just
up,
practically speaking, I'm talking about, yeah. too, because you want the rail the same distance all the way around the court.
Put it anywhere. It's, you know, put a piece of string, get a post. It's rough. It's rough out there. I'm glad I got traction. I'm glad he followed it up. We deserve better information, but it's pretty elementary. How far is the race, and how long does it take them to negotiate it? It seems to be really right up there with the sun coming up in the east. So obviously he got some traction, and Tim Ritvo obviously in a tough position, which is funny. Tim Ritvo was out at Santa Anita. I know it's still a Frank Stronach track, but Gulfstream was running. But you know, he said they're going to look into it. He also said that they weren't going to do that again, the apparent. So watch these 7.5 furlong races. Now, if you also remember, Seth, last year, they sort of dumped the 7.5 furlong races in December. Once the meet really got underway, they walked away from them. But obviously, these trainers love them, etc. But it's a mess. As I say all the time on the Handicappers Report, trust yourself. As an example of that, I say this all the time about trainers and what we do. Bill Mott, one of the greatest trainers of the last 30 years, youngest trainer in the Hall of Fame, after one poor start on turf, where he was between horses, put Kid Cruz in for a $50,000 tag, making his debut on dirt, lost him to Linda Rice, and the horse won by a pole. Bill Mott in the Hall of Fame, after one turf try, puts him on dirt first time, loses him. I don't think he's getting them back.
And speaking of Kid Cruz, this guy was kind of interesting. Yesterday at Ocala, one of the higher-priced, one of the seven-figure horses was a sibling to Kid Cruz. And I'm sure the group that put that horse in, really happy with what happened over the weekend.
I'll tell you a quick, Seth is 100% right. He's making an assumption, but that assumption is correct. I've told this story many, many times before. Landa Lucy broke her maiden. Landa Lucy's full sister, when the sales ring days later, the great Dolly Green paid $1.5 million. If you don't think that debut by Landa Lucy had anything to do with it,
sure
it had
that incredible weekend
life
performance made a big difference.
But there's
yesterday.
Bill Mott, and I've said this before, I would never put a horse in a claiming tag until A, they've run on both surfaces, and B, they've run without and
but
with blinkers.
Did you read the follow up? There was seller's remorse. They bought back into the horse.
Well, yeah. And the only thing I know about the buying back into the horse, the name of the place, the stable, is that beautiful place down in Chile for resort people that I'll never get to.
All right. We will take a look at the racing for
Tampa
this afternoon now. Going to start things out at Tampa, go over to Gulfstream a little later on. But the opener at Tampa this afternoon, maiden claimer, 7,000 to 8,000 tags, four-year-olds and up, going 7 furlongs.
And I've said it before, I love the 7 furlong races out of Tampa Bay because they do come out of the trees, but in their television production, they give us the head-ons, which I think are invaluable for trip. Handicappers 2, 4, 11, ladies and gentlemen, kicking it off. And number 2 draws the rail in here. Principale going out for the second career start after debuting at 30-1. We won't get that price this afternoon, but we are looking at double-digit odds on the morning line. And in conventional wisdom, going 7/8 of a mile, we think about it at Saratoga often, certainly outside of our studios, it can be a tough place to go. But statistically speaking, not so much. That horses have great success coming out of the inside post position. This past summer at Saratoga, after being accurate for many years, boy, I thought the rail going 7/8 wasn't so awful. So we get the second career start. We debuted going 5.5, finished third, a well-beaten third, but I think that was really more about the winners. Now we get the second start. We draw down inside. We won't be near the price we were in the debut, but we're going to take our chances from the rail with the deuce on top. For second, number 4, Seeking a Babe. Harry Vega gets the mount here this afternoon for the seventh career start. This horse most recently went 6 furlongs, changed barns, comes into a sharper operation, and I like the effort, showing good speed right out of the gate. Not so much after that, but we are at 8-1, and I'll take my chances. And for third, the outside horse, number 11, Risen Spirit, a good third place finish going 7/8 in a quality pace effort. Now going to the post for the 14th time, only hit the board once. That once was the most recent. I've said it before. Yes, there are horses such as number 7, Western Concern, who is 0-0-0 for for 15, but this athlete is not going in the right direction. I'm thinking maybe number 11, Risen Spirit, is going in the right direction. Get a small piece in the opener at Tampa Bay, 2-4-11.
And I should say, I didn't mention it when you and I were on Monday, and I don't always watch what the other handicappers are doing. I have to admit, I don't always pull up the printable sheet from the OTB page, particularly when I'm playing by myself, because I don't want to be influenced in any way. But I was watching you on Friday. You had a very, very good day down at Gulfstream on Friday. Yeah. Ripped off, was it, the first four to start with? First four or five?
First four, and I say, it is what it is, the price. I got surprised by two of the prices.
Had a couple of decent prices in there and a couple of chalky.
The first two were short. They bet them stronger than I anticipated, et cetera, but they did get home, and then the waters got good. It was a very good day. Thank you.
All right, race number two at Tampa today, a maiden claimer, 10 to 12,500. Fillies, three-year-old fillies going 6 furlongs.
9, 7, and 1, ladies and gentlemen. These three-year-olds, Strawberry Wine, gets my top pick. And we're on the outside with Angel Sherpa in the saddle, who was aboard the most recent effort, which was a Tampa Bay second-place finish, behind a long, just a very convincing winner. Now, that was the addition of blinkers. I think it did help. And sometimes when you're looking at the running lines, you know, I like to think of it as a function of this horse is doing okay. The running line is looking worse because it is made to look worse by the other athlete. What I mean is this horse showed good speed, was in touch with the field, was just the other horse was running away. I've said it many times before. Horses get in positions where you're thinking, you can't lose from here, and they lose. They get double demerits from me. Or you're thinking, you know, like Sahara Sky the other day in the San Carlos in California. Now, they were deep in the card on Saturday afternoon. You knew speed was good, but I have to tell you, at about the 5/16 pole with Rosario, I'm like, this is the best horse in the race. Rosario's going to find a way to get through, and he's going to find the victory, because I think inside was good at Santa Anita. I liked Strawberry Wine's most recent effort. Got beat better than half a dozen, but that was a function of the winner. We draw on the outside. I think that's advantageous. We'll take the 9 on top for second. 2 over, number 7, Gems Pride, making the 4th career start. Coming out of the Gerald Bennett barn, who has been going evenly at a high success rate since the beginning of this meet. Another horse who got to the 8th pole going 7 furlongs in front, got run over the top. Chucky Santos gets the mount for 3rd. Number 1, Dennis Ward sends out this horse for the 3rd start. Lost the debut at 4-1. Came back, ran a little better going 2 turns as the 2-1 favorite. Now shortens back up to a sprint. 9-7-1 in the second.
Race number 3 this afternoon, a conditional claimer, 12,500 tags. Non-winners of 2 lifetime. The condition, these are 3-year-olds and up. They'll go 7 furlongs.
7, 6, and 3, my selections in here. And Determinate gets my top pick in here. They're going to add blinkers, talking about earlier for me, you know, how quickly I would surmise that a horse should be dropped in for a tag. I would be trying both surfaces. I would be trying blinkers to see if anything popped, and I think that this is a reasonable try after this horse ran for claiming 16,000, just restricted to 3-year-olds, but not restricted to 2Ls. This horse raced well on the pace and then absolutely spit the bit going 7 furlongs. We draw the outside. We get blinkers on this afternoon. Workouts indicate that they're going to really go with this horse. The upside to that for me is in the 2nd career start on December 7th, they did that. They scored by a nose. That was going 6.5. They're going to add the blinkers. They need to negotiate an extra half furlong. For a second, right next door in the starting, number 6, Fit and Frisky, making the first start since winning by a pole at Timonium, going a mile, winning by 4. I'm not sure if that isn't 3 turns at Timonium, the Maryland State Fair, ladies and gentlemen. Makes the first start versus winners this afternoon. And for 3rd, number 2, Proud Patriot, big price in here. Poor effort most recently, but previous in East Boston, this horse was hitting the board in all 4 career starts. It hasn't gone nearly as well at Tampa Bay Downs, probably while we're getting 15-1 in the morning line. 7-6-2.
4th race this afternoon, $8,000 conditional claimer. Non-winners of 3 lifetime. The condition, 3-year-olds and up, 3/4 of a mile.
Like this race very much. 2, 10, and 8. Number 2 is Raven Train. Gets my top pick here. Scored in the 2L, 2 races back. Then went up to the 3L, but for twice the price in here. So when the restricted level is the same, I think it does allow you then to revert to the old days, the price tag. So you ran for 16 3L, now you're running for 8 3L. I think it's a different group of animal. Dean Butler gets them out for the first time. As I said, this horse scored at 13-1 at Tampa, two races back, going to throw out the most recent effort, and at 10-1 down inside, we're going to take the deuce on top. For a second, the other side of the starting gate on the outside, number 10, Chia Spice, Fernando de la Cruz. He gets the mount back after being runner-up at even money most recently. For third, number 8, Ardency, going out after getting beat at 4-5. Now, folks, this horse has made 8 career starts, never been off the board, never been higher than 3-1. 6 starts at Tampa in the book after debuting at Woodbine, 2-2-2. A major player, and if the morning line does hold up, and we're looking at 3.5-1, I think this horse is in the mix for me, but under no circumstances does a horse with this record, which does seem glittering, and I'm not saying it's fool's gold, but be very careful. I've had plenty enough opportunities where this horse fit, and the owners probably love this horse getting a check, but for the bettors, beware. 2-10-8.
Fifth race this afternoon, a claiming event, $7,000 to $8,000 tags. These are 4-year-olds and up, going 6.
10-8-1, my selections in here, ladies and gentlemen. And the 10 going out this afternoon for the second start since being in East Boston in the autumn. Ran on January 25th, lost by a nose under Harry Vega. He takes the call back. We get the outside post, which I think is advantageous in here. Horse has good speed. Be interested to see if Harry Vega puts his horse on the front and tries to never look back. I wouldn't be against that at all. For a second, number 8, Rocky Gap, going out for Dennis Ward. First off the claim for $5,000. Now, Dennis Ward is about a 33% first off the claim. He claimed this runner from Jamie Ness off of the victory at even money in the Tampa debut, which was off the May 25th layoff coming back on February 21st. I said this before the other day about Mucho Macho Man. I do not like horses second off when they run big first off. You can call it muscle regression, anything you like. I expect to get less of a performance. But 10-1 on the morning line, which attracted me. And for third, number 1, Paradise Rock, dropping down, trying to go 4-for-4, 3 in a row at Tampa, 3-for-4 lifetime. 10-8-1.
All right, we'll take our first break. When we come back, we'll complete our look at Tampa a little later on, Gulfstream Park. Stay tuned. Hoops fans, March Tournament Madness is upon us, and there is no better place to catch all the action than the Clubhouse Racebook. With over 260 flat-screen TVs, fabulous food and drink specials, and a great lineup of contests, the Clubhouse is the place to follow your favorite college hoops teams. The Tournament Madness gets into full swing Thursday, March 20th. Don't make your reservations now by calling 438-0127. The Clubhouse Racebook, the better choice for racing and sports. I'm Seth Merrill. Join me weekdays at 10 for Racing Across America. We'll look at important races from around the country, get insight from top handicappers and analysts, and preview the upcoming week in racing. That's Racing Across America, weekdays at 10, right here on the OTB TV network.
No one provides bettors with more wagering options than Capital OTB. Our network of branch and easy bet locations stretches from the mid-Hudson Valley all the way to the Canadian border and west to central New York. So whether you need to place a bet, fund your Capital Bets account, or watch the next big race, all the action is just around the corner. A full list of our branch and easy bet locations can be found online at CapitalOTB.com. Capital OTB, the better and most convenient choice for wagering in upstate New York.
I got it. Watch me. I got it. Hey! I got some
something that makes me want to shout. I got something that tells me what it's all about. I got a move that tells me what to do.
Race fans, head down to the all-new Clubhouse Racebook. With live horse racing on more than 250 flat-screen TVs, state-of-the-art wagering terminals, and amazing Vegas-style atmosphere, the Clubhouse Racebook, 711 Central Avenue, Albany.
Welcome back to the Handicappers Report on this Wednesday morning. Happy to be joining you, Anthony Mormino, Seth Merrill. We'll continue now our look at Tampa Bay Downs for this afternoon. With their race number 6, optional claiming event, $40,000 tags, non-winners of 2 other than fillies and mares, 4-year-olds and up on the grass at 5 furlongs.
836, ladies and gentlemen, and as much as turf sprinting has become the rage, Seth, around the country, we certainly have seen that front and center at Saratoga Racecourse. Not so much at Tampa Bay Downs. I mean, it's popular at Gulfstream Park, but at Tampa Bay Downs, they don't use their turf course for sprinting very much. 836, ladies and gentlemen, and number 8 is In Spite, my top pick here. And you know, one thing I've tried to do as I've gotten older is that, you know, I was predisposed to being ambivalent about Spicetown as a stallion, but I've been talking about it for 4 months now, how he has chased the unbelievably magnificent Galileo through the year from a stallion standpoint. So if I think, you know, how great I think about Galileo, that I actually believe he will supersede his track record as a stallion. Well, Spicetown, no matter what I originally thought, if he's chasing him, has been a stupendous sire. Sprint champion a decade ago. You have the pedigree for turf, but to me, when you're going 5 furlongs or 5.5 furlongs, they are dirt races. And in case Seth and I was talking about the Horse Players show, on Esquire TV, which is where I've caught it on the internet, you know, there's a scene that I thought was actually, from a handicapping standpoint, very good, except for me, it was about 4 years too late, and that is they go see John Velasquez, and John Velasquez talks about how turf sprints are far more like dirt racing on green stuff than turf racing conducted a distance of ground. It took me about 2 summers at Saratoga to really not be very interested about the turf pedigree in turf sprints and be more interested in sprinters. Well, we have a sprint champion who's been very, very good in the stallion, but makes the first start since November 21st for a horse who has good early speed. Usually fresh horses, they use that speed. We're on the outside, we're 10 to 1. Number 8, In Spite, my top pick for second. Number 3, Gift Receipt. Tape those at the top of the boxes when you give gifts. I thought a good performance at better than 20 to 1 now. One thing I'll say about, if you're looking at the daily racing form or past performances for this race, you see Gift Receipt, you see coming, making the front of the fractions of 20 and 4 and then 43 and 4. And obviously, we rarely ever see them unless it's 6 furlongs at Churchill Downs or Monmouth Park because of the teletimer, because of the run-up. But I'll say this, of the few races that they've run, and when I say few, I think they've run about 6 5 furlong turf sprints at this meet. When the rail has been positioned where it was on January 25th, they nearly always seem to give us the fastest times. I know this was a rare turf sprint stakes race. I think they've had 2 of them. But trust me, I think the teletimer is very, very liberal in the tele. So don't worry about that this is the fastest horse on 4 legs. And for third, number 6, going out for the second start since Labor Day weekend. I will say this. This horse got run down. It was the biggest closer winning at these. This wasn't a case, I think, where you were home at the 8th pole. You got run over. This was a strong pace race. The winner was the biggest closer. I have no problem with getting run over the top in that scenario. 836.
7th race this afternoon, an optional claiming starter allowance event. 8,000 in the optional claiming category. 5,000 in the starter allowance. These are 4-year-olds and up going a mile and 40.
I just want to give, my numbers here are 371. I just want to give you a mile 40 yards at Tampa Bay Downs, a very, very popular distance. There have been 90 races at this distance. It's a popular off-the-turf distance also. There have been five races where you have been greater than three lengths off the pace and have scored. So that is not, as of this moment, a recipe for success. 60 out of the 90, two-thirds, have been within one length or better. I mean, it's amazing how good speed has been and on the pace at these mile 40 yards into the short run. So looking at that, it's 3-7-1 for me, long to win. I'm going to go back to two races back. I'm going to forget the most recent effort, but two races back, going a mile 40. This was one of the fastest mile 40 races of the meet. I bring that up because this was a claiming 62.50, which is the bottom level. Three quarters of the faster ones were all allowance races. This was a very good race two races back. I'm not surprised at the mile and 16th race, and I don't think it was the mile and 16th. I think it was the big effort two races back that paid the price most recently. We bounce forward, and with Ronnie Allen Jr. back in the saddle, we run anywhere similar to the January 4th. I think we're down the road. For second, number seven, Galaxy Cat, a good third place finish, going 5.5, an offspring of Empire Maker stretching out. And for third, number one, Big Lucky, huge price in here, 3-7-1. In the seventh.
Eighth race today, an optional claiming event, $32,000 tags. Non-winners are two other than the condition. Four-year-olds and up on the grass at a mile and a 16th.
4-1-10, ladies and gentlemen. Enrico Suave coming out at my top pick. 3-for-9 lifetime on the turf. The most recent efforts have been on the dirt. You got to look back. You get a Canterbury race this past summer in Minnesota, a second-place finish. But the one that I like, 2-for-4 lifetime on the Tampa turf. For a second, number one, going out for Gary Jackson, who is four winners at this meet. Two of them, Golden Beach Bye, with this jockey, who was aboard coming off of a third-place finish on the turf two races back. And for third, the 10, 4-1-10 in the eighth.
Ninth race today at Tampa. It is a optional claiming event, $75,000 tags. Non-winners are one other than the condition. These are three-year-olds, and they will go 6.5.
Feature this afternoon, 8, 7, and 9, as I am on the outside. And for me, Stormy Pacific coming in here, never been off the board. Three starts, a gold, a silver, and a bronze medal so far. That's a win, a place in the show. Dale Bennett's runner won the second career start, and then first time versus winners going 7, a nice second-place finish. For a second, number seven, early entry. Kathleen O'Connell, who's had a terrific meet, puts his horse in for a tag for the second time in a row after winning at this level under the allowance conditions, two back and for third at a big price with Dean Butler. Number nine, won the career debut in East Boston, then shipped down to Tampa Bay for four races, including a stakes try and then a victory at this level for the tag, 8-7-9.
Finale today at Tampa, race number 10, a $16,000 claimer. These are fillies, three-year-olds, going a mile on the grass.
And one thing, you're talking about things that helps you to remember, I love Carson City in the pedigree on the turf, and Carson City was a good sprinter for Wayne Lucas and Mr. Young many moons ago, but I love him as a turf influence middle distance at the max. 5-1-9, Speckles gets my top pick. Scores a victory on the turf debut most recently, going the mile at Tampa at 10-1 with the addition of blinkers. For a second, number one, Misfire. Big price in here with Quincy Hamilton, but I think we have a wake-up horse in here. I like the third place finish a couple of days after Christmas at Tampa. And for third, the outside horse, Dennis Ward, claimed number nine, Magnificent X, for 12.5, then tried starter allowance, now gets a much softer spot off of the maiden claiming victory. 5-1-9 in the 10th and final from Tampa Bay.
All right, we'll take our next break and concentrate on Gulfstream. When we come back, stay tuned.
Each morning on the OTB TV network, you get the very best in horse racing programming. Weekdays begin with the Handicappers Report, where professional handicappers share their selections and analysis of the day's racing. Followed by Racing Across America, a daily conversation with racing personalities from around the country. Saturdays include Down the Stretch, where Mark Cassano speaks with the biggest names in racing. And Sunday mornings, it's Loose on the Lead, where Steve Bick and I offer news and a unique lineup of weekly guests. All here on the OTB TV network.
Wagering at CapitalOTBBet.com is as easy as 1, 2, 3. 1. Capital Bet TV, the fastest and easiest online wagering experience where you can monitor 5 different tracks simultaneously. 2. Capital Bet Express, its straightforward program layout and interactive handicapping information lets you build your wager quickly and efficiently. And 3. Capital Bet Pro, designed especially for the professional horse player. CapitalOTBBet.com. Log on today.
Missed one of our TV shows? No worries. Now you can catch all your favorite programs online. Simply log on to CapitalOTB.com and click on the YouTube link at the bottom of the homepage. And look for our new podcast coming soon. CapitalOTB.com. Log on today.
Welcome back, ladies and gentlemen, to the Handicappers Report alongside Seth Murrow. I am Anthony Mormino. It's Wednesday, which means it should be sun-filled South Florida weather. I just did Tampa Bay with Gulfstream Park, and obviously if you're watching, I mean, I don't follow it closely. It's just a rough March day today, but I guess from Chicago to Seth's second favorite place, Maine, is a little rough with the weather. Hopefully we're going to avoid it because I know we have had enough. But Gulfstream Park, hopefully the sun will be shining, and hopefully we'll have the starting gate somewhere near. I've quoted it 3 times off the air. I like Timothy Ridfoe's response. 200 feet is definitely too far. Well, Tim, how do you feel about 375? In the opener, on the dirt, Phillies and Mares, maiden claimers in for 12-5, racing 6.
I have it 1, 4, 3, and 2. The number one is Broadway Secret. Speed popped them last time and faded, but now comes back in 5 days. I always find that interesting. And the cutback. Last time that speed pop and fade job was at a mile, cuts back to 6 furlongs today. So the quick comeback and the cutback make Broadway Secret kind of interesting in here to me. So number one on top, number four, Distinctly Sweet in the second spot. This horse is lately raced, but has shown a little bit of ability. A couple of starts only for this four-year-old in November, and then a little bit of a layoff to early in January. Now another little bit of a layoff. Last time was second, a well-beaten second as the 6-5 favorite. But again, this is a field where a number of them have had plenty of chances. And this one, as I say, shown a little bit of ability so far in a couple of starts. Third spot, the number three, Starship Debutante. Like my top selection, cuts back off racing longer over the past few starts and showed speed last time. So the speed coming out of that last race and the cutback today puts Starship Debutante in my mix. In the opener, 1, 4, 3, and 2.
On to the second half of the early daily double. Phillies and Maris once again. Optional claimers in for 25 or starter allowance 16. On the turf, going a mile in a 16th.
6, 4, 2, and 1. The number 6 is Blues and Silvers. Comes in from Southern California with some solid buyers. If this horse gets back to those with the move over to the East Coast, absolutely going to be right up there in the hunt. And that workout the other day at Gulfstream, the 46 and change, says that this horse is on its toes after the move east. Second spot, we'll go with the number 4, Wild Suava. Goes out for trainer Mike Maker. Has some improving numbers over the past 3 starts, including a win last time in a $50,000 starter allowance. Those types of races are very salty. I think this horse is going to fit very nicely in with this crew today and be very competitive. Javier Castellano was on board last time, back on board again today. Third spot, the number 2, Zero Game. A European import that has shown some flashes in the first 3 starts here in the United States. A couple of good efforts that bookend a dud in the Grade 2 Mrs. Revere at Churchill Downs. That typically, year in and year out, is a pretty good race down there at Churchill. And this one showed a little punch early but faded badly. I'm going to draw a line through that. Again, class-wise, may have just been a little too tough. I think Zero Game in this particular field is going to be competitive. So in the second race today at Gulfstream, 6, 4, 2, and 1.
On to the third race, staying with the Phillies and Mares. Claimers in for 12-5, non-winners of 3, lifetime, racing 7-8.
I have it 5, 3, 7, and 2. The number 5 is Tale of Peace. Goes out for Frank Calabrese. Claimed this horse last time. This horse has some back numbers and going first off the claim for some potent connections. I'm hoping we can get back to some of those better numbers. If so, I think Tale of Peace is going to be very, very interesting in here today and picks up the services of Javier Castellano. Second spot, Money for Memories. Just, to me, this horse actually was on top. I was kind of going back and forth, and I was giving this horse a slight nod on the class relief, and I went back and forth and eventually just tilted in favor of Tale of Peace. But I do think Money for Memories is probably going to be the one to beat on that class relief. Takes a cut in claiming price from 30 to 12.5, pretty significant drop, and had been, competitive, running okay against the higher company. So I think this horse with the class drop today will fit right in with this particular bunch. Again, I went back and forth, and I wouldn't argue with somebody that put Money for Memories on top, but I have it in the second spot today. And then we'll go out to the number seven, Rowdy Miss. This horse needs to rebound. Like my second selection in here, this horse has some back numbers, and maybe with the class drop today will rebound to those. The last race was a little bit of a concern, threw an absolute dud there. But races just prior to that were pretty good. And with the class relief today, might get back to those. I'm willing to forgive one effort, but we won't know until today whether that was just a signal if this one is going in the wrong direction or not. I'm willing to bet that this horse will rebound a little bit, though, as I say, with the class relief. Third race, 5, 3, 7, and 2.
On to the fourth race this afternoon. Three-year-olds, optional claimers in for 25. Starter allowance, 25, racing a mile.
1, 5, 2, and 6. The number one is Quarton Lake. I just think this horse might be primed to go well in an angle I like. Third start, I like it third start off the layout, but it works just as well early in the career. Third start of the career, stretching out after a couple of sprints. Nice improvement start one to start two. Now that stretch out won't shock me at all if this horse runs very well in the third career start. Now, that said, the last race was the maiden breaker, so this horse is going in to a little bit saltier competition. We're going to get 5-1 on the morning line. Hopefully that'll hold up, though. Again, just on the angle, the improving form, I think this horse might be primed for another good effort today. So I'll take a little shot with the number one, Quarton Lake, on top. Number five, predicting in the second spot. Pretty solid numbers as compared to the rest of this particular bunch, and the move back to the dirt I think is going to be beneficial. This horse was on the dirt two starts back in an off-the-turf race on the Sloppy Seal track. Ran an okay, fourth in a field of six that day, but it was, as I say, okay with a decent number. Bumped up to an optional claimer starter allowance last time on the turf. The number improved nicely. Now, back to the dirt. Blinkers come off. Again, just compared to the rest of this field, I think predicting is going to be absolutely competitive. And then number two, El Beats. Nice improving numbers, really, overall, five of the first starts so far in the career. And this one's coming off a win at a 16 claimer. So in some pretty good form right now with, as I say, nice improving numbers. In the fourth, 1, 5, 2, and 6.
On to the fifth race, four-year-olds up. Claimers in for 30,000. Non-winners of two lifetime. Going the very much talked about. Be very interesting how they handled today's 7.5 furlong turf race.
4, 1, 8, and 3. The number four is Marine, and hasn't seen the winner's circle in a while. We have to go back to, March of 2013, but it's been fairly lightly raced since then. I think this horse looks to fit with this particular bunch. This horse, buyer figures in the last three starts here at Gulfstream seem to, be pretty competitive just looking out at the complexion of the rest of this field. So, again, this is a horse hard to get super enthusiastic about in the seems a little camera shy over the last year or so, but has been lightly raced, and overall I think it's going to be a good fit. So we'll take a shot with number four, Marine, on top. We'll go inside to the number one, Ginger Goose, in the second spot. This is a horse that seems to be in some pretty good form. Claimed last time. The trainer doesn't shoot particularly good first off the claim stats, but it's with a limited sample. But again, I just think this horse is in some pretty good form right now. And another one that just looking at the rest of the field, I think is going to be a cozy fit. And then the number eight, Forever Conga, showed some nice closing punch last time. If we get anything like that this time, Forever Conga will certainly be worth paying a little bit of attention to in the lane. In the fifth, 4, 1, 8, and 3.
We're going to take a quick break. When we come back, second half of today's action from Gulfstream Park.
Hoops fans, March Tournament Madness is upon us, and there is no better place to catch all the action than the Clubhouse Racebook. With over 260 flat-screen TVs,
fabulous food and drink specials, and a great lineup of contests, the clubhouse is the place to follow your favorite college hoops teams.
The tournament madness gets into full swing Thursday, March 20th.
So make your reservations now by calling 438-0127. The Clubhouse Racebook, the better choice for racing and sports.
I'm Steve Beck.
And I'm Seth Merrill.
Together, we're Loose on the Lead on Capital OTB, Sundays at 10 a.m. Why should they watch, Seth?
Sit down on Sunday, have a bagel, get some great racing conversation.
Cream cheese only, no jelly. Sundays, 10 a.m., Loose on the Lead, Capital OTB.
Using CapitalOTBBet.com is as easy as 1, 2, 3. 1, simply log on with your username and password from the homepage. 2, fund your Capital OTB account through our Easy Money, Green Dot, or Visa MasterCard options. And 3, place your bet on one of our three easy-to-navigate wagering platforms, Capital Bet TV, Capital Bet Express, or Capital Bet Pro. CapitalOTBBet.com. Log on today.
Here in upstate New York, no one provides bettors with more wagering options than Capital OTB. Our network of ranch and easy bet locations stretches from the mid-Hudson Valley all the way to the Canadian border and west to central New York. So whether you need to place a bet, fund your Capital Bets account, or watch the next big race, all the action is just around the corner. A full list of our branch and easy bet locations can be found online at CapitalOTB.com. Capital OTB, the better and most convenient choice for wagering in upstate New York.
Funding your Capital OTB bet account is as easy as 1, 2, 3. 1, easy money. Clearly the fastest and easiest method of depositing funds into your account. Make deposits or withdrawals in just minutes. 2, Green Dot Money Pack gives you instant access to your funds. Green Dot Money Packs are available at thousands of retailers nationwide. And 3, MasterCard Visa. Simply click on the link from the funding page, enter your account information, and fund your account. CapitalOTBBet.com. Log on today.
I'm Mark Cassano. Join me Saturday mornings at 10 for Down the Stretch. We'll inform, analyze, and welcome in the biggest names in racing. So join me Saturday mornings at 10 for Down the Stretch, right here on the OTB Television Network.
Welcome back to the Handicappers Report alongside Seth Merrill. I am Anthony Mormino in the midst of Gulfstream Park. We're up to race number 6. We have 4-year-olds and up. Optional claimers in for 62. Non-winners are 2 other than on the dirt going 6.
5, 2, 7, and 6. The number 5 is Evolution Rocks. Triple-digit buyers in the last 2 starts. Has some nice early speed. Has been off since a race at Calder. A little stakes race over there. Front-end job. But again, I think in the form over the last couple with those triple-digit buyers, Evolution Rocks could prove very, very tough in here. But confrontation for a Barkley Tag, I think it's going to be a little bit interesting. This is a horse that's undefeated in 3 career starts. First couple of starts in the career were up at Saratoga. Did debut for a maiden claiming tag, but won that pretty convincingly with a pretty solid 96 buyer figure. And now it's been off since October. So maybe a little, again, it's a little more potent to me, the 2-year-old to 3-year-old break. You can come back with some added maturity. But I think it's true as well for lightly raised 3-year-olds when they make that break and come back as 4-year-olds. This horse could come back with a little added maturity and be kind of interesting today. We'll have to step it up, but I think that's possible. So confrontation in the second spot for me. And then I'm going to go to the number 7, Guam Typhoon. Guam Typhoon is just a game old 8-year-old, has won half of the 30 career starts, has almost $500,000 in the bank. And from the last few starts, probably has to step it up a little bit, but certainly there's some back numbers that says this horse is capable of that. So I'll throw Guam Typhoon into the mix as well. 6th race, 5, 2, 7, and 6.
On to the 7th race, 4-year-olds and up. Claimers in for 16, non-winners of 3 lifetime, going 7.5 on the turf.
1, 2, 3, and 9. The number 1 is Barzini, and I think there's going to be some speed to shoot at in here. You have a few horses that I think have enough early speed that it just will set it up for maybe a little bit of a closing kick from Barzini. But again, you do have to keep in mind that's always a little bit of a chore and a little bit of a piece of guesswork in what the jockeys are going to do. You hope those speed horses will go out and not necessarily duel themselves into submission, but at least set up an honest pace that Barzini can shoot at. If so, I think Barzini could be a player in the lane. Number 2, Defiant, will be one of those speed horses, and speed is going to always be dangerous. The question mark for me for this one went through the N2L condition last time, and sometimes they'll just take a start or two to figure out the next condition up. So this one moves from N2 to N3, and that was just what shied me away from using this one on top a little bit. And then in the third spot, the number three, Cairo 6, just capable on the best effort. We saw a good effort two starts back. If we get back to that one, this horse will certainly be up in the hunt today. In the seventh, 1, 2, 3, and 9.
And other than when Saratoga opens on Wednesdays, as it's done the vast majority of my time, one of the most talked about Wednesday races. I wonder if they just handed Mr. McGahey the slip to write the conditions for the race because it's impossible. What I couldn't figure out in this, Seth, is why wouldn't they just have written, he must not have wanted older horses in here, like three-year-olds and up, optional claimers, non-winners and two other than. But that's the condition he needed. But it comes up with, for three-year-olds, non-winners of a sweepstakes since November 1st, which they would also have eliminated the Breeders' Cup winners, et cetera. So very, circuitous way to get to a condition for a three-year-old debut.
And this is the three-year-old debut of Honor Code. And I put Honor Code on top, 4, 1, and 2. And it's a short four-horse field, as Anthony alludes. It's a race that clearly is written to get this horse the three-year-old debut. They talked about going in the race this weekend at Oaklawn, the stakes race. Shug McGahey, though, based over at Gulfstream, obviously, so they don't have to ship out for this. So if you've read the articles, McGahey has said, gee, we don't have to win, but we're in it to win. So I'm going to put Honor Code on top. I think Honor Code on talent is certainly the one to beat in here. However, that said, I would not argue at all with somebody taking a shot with social inclusion. Because, again, McGahey is saying we're in it to win. And I think class and talent-wise, Honor Code is probably the one. But they're not going to knock the horse dead coming down the stretch, given that they have much bigger fish to fry coming up on the schedule. So if there's too much to do in the lane, social inclusion, the number one horse, may prove very, very tough in this race. A nice front-end win last time, very quick here at Gulfstream, nice solid buyer figure, working out well since then. Social inclusion from the rail. If this one gets out there and takes a nice, easy lead in a short field, I don't think that's out of the question at all. Social inclusion could be very tough. I'm tossing this in there. If you're a Rainbow Six player or whatnot today, I wouldn't make Honor Code a free square, so to speak. I think social inclusion would have to be on your ticket as well. So that's in the second spot for me. And then the number two, we're all set, just on some improving numbers over the past three. But I think there are two in here that are very, very intriguing. Honor Code, absolutely. But social inclusion, given the whole scenario of this race, is also very, very interesting. 4, 1, and 2 for me.
Is it fair to say that Honor Code will be at best 1-5?
I'll be interested because I think the betting public will be clued into exactly what I'm clued in. I think with this one looking like the absolute speed over that Gulfstream Park strip, I will be interested to see how much action social inclusion takes.
Fair enough. On to the ninth. Three-year-old fillies, maiden claimers in for 75 on the turf, going 7.5.
5, 2, 7, and 9 for me. The number 5 is Bartiromo, daughter of Street Boss. They paid $65,000 for this horse at a two-year-old in training sale last year. Debuted for $60,000 and didn't show much there. That was 6 furlongs on the dirt here, but it is Chad Brown. His horses can show some improvement second time out of the box. I think there's a little breeding here. I think it's interesting that on the move to grass, they move up the claiming ranks. That shows some confidence. Javier Castellano jumps on board. I just think it's kind of interesting, the scenario here in the second career start. So Bartiromo on top. Second spot, the number 4, Starship Sassy. Last couple of starts has shown some life. This is a horse that has 9 career starts and hasn't gotten it done yet. But again, it's shown a little bit of life in the past too. Wouldn't surprise me to see that continue. And then the number 7, Janes Paul, who 4 career starts. The last one was at this 75 tag. Prior to that at Maiden Special, showed some nice life running a close-up 5th last time with the drop-in for this tag, so seems to have found the comfort zone. Race number 9 today, 5, 4, 7, and 9.
And in the finale, 3-year-old fillies, maiden claimers in for 25, dashing 5 on the turf.
9, 6, 7, and 5 for me. The number 9 is Chief Dante, just on the class move. Pretty significant maiden special to maiden claiming a drop. Goes in for a 25 tag. So as I say, that's a fairly significant drop. And last couple of maiden special races were decent. So I think this horse will appreciate the drop. Second spot, we will go to the number 6, Rogue Lady. Another one getting some class relief. This horse has been in for a tag a couple of times. And if you go 3 starts back, showed some life for a 40 tag. Now comes back for 25, a drop from 50 last time. So with the class relief, we'll throw that one in. And then the number 7, Shot Girl. You got to go back to the career debut to see the best effort buyer-wise and finishing position-wise, but do note, that was 5 furlongs on the turf. This one hasn't seen that particular situation since that career debut. With the move back to that scenario today, we'll throw that one in the mix. In the finale, 9, 6, 7, and 5.
And that wraps up our look at both Gulfstream Park and Tampa Bay Downs this afternoon on Capital Off Track Betting TV 12, our lineup consists of Tampa Bay Downs getting us kicked off, followed by Laurel, Gulfstream, Fairgrounds, Turf Paradise, Northfield, Penn National, Delta Downs, Mountaineer, Pompano, then Australia A and B. If you missed any of Seth or my selections, please go to CapitalOTV.com, click on the Handicappers Report, get a full listing of all of our selections for Tampa Bay and Gulfstream Park. We invite you to sign up for a Capital Bets account. You go to CapitalOTVBet.com. Simplest way to play the game on our state-of-the-art wagering platform. You get live streaming video, race replays, etc., etc. Also, it makes you eligible for the many contests we run throughout the year at Capital Off Track Betting, including, it's not a contest, but the Bet 50, Get 50. You sign up for a new account. Once you bet $50, Capital Off Track Betting replenishes your account with $50 for the racetrack. Up next, Seth, who do you have on Racing Across America?
Regular Wednesday visit from Jeremy Plonk, horseplayernow.com, and Countdown to the Crown. It's Countdown to the Crown season, so we'll look back at some of our very good 3-year-old action from this past weekend. And then John Burrell, and I have to check his name. Burrell, I'm not quite
Tampa
sure.
Tampa Bay.
But he does the Tampa Bay Handicapper website, so we'll get some thoughts on Tampa Bay for this afternoon, and also get some of his recap thoughts from the weekend down there as well.
I'll tell you what, tight on time, so just a quick comment. I'll tell you what, these horses run so infrequently. I was looking at Steve Haskins' Derby Dozen the other day. I was like, oh, yeah, where you been? Ladies and gentlemen, enjoy your afternoon. Up next, Racing Across America.
You're watching OTB TV, a service of Capital Off-Track Betting.